So as introduced, Kurt Brown, managed the data platform, and I've talked a few times in the past at conferences, if you've seen me, about our transition from the data center to the cloud and the technologies we adopted along the way. But today you get the super bonus version. This is how we're, the next step, how we're making things bigger and faster and easier. I just threw bigger in there, it's not on the slide. But first a question for you. Does anyone here not know what Netflix is? If you don't, raise your hand. Okay, I'm not gonna believe that guy, so I'm gonna skip the slide. So what you might not know though is that over a third of internet traffic in North America during the peak hours is Netflix. So this is YouTube, HTTP, like everything. You guys are watching a lot of Netflix. And this translates to over 100 million hours watched per day across the world. We have over 65 million members across 50 countries. Some people know that we're in the US, some people don't. Or we actually know we're in the US, but outside the US. And then outside the US, tragically, if you're a DVD fan, you don't get Netflix. You can only get it for streaming. So you have to either get over that or move to America. So another thing you may or may not know is almost all of our infrastructure is in the Amazon cloud. Our content delivery network is an exception that we sort of cell phone, and that's what actually streams the bits and bytes, but all the control planes, all the data stores, all the analytics, all that stuff is in the Amazon cloud. There are a few little exceptions. One is that we have a teeny sliver of billing that's still in the data center, and I keep saying, it's almost out, and I was assured that by the end of the year, it will be out, and then we'll be 100% in the Amazon cloud, other than outside of data center stuff that I mentioned before. So one thing that's really cool that you probably never heard of is this thing called Hadoop, and we've been using this for a little while. It's actually seeming kind of old school with all the Spark around buzz, or all the buzz around Spark lately. But I will talk a little bit about Hadoop in this conference. It is a Hadoop conference after all. One of the biggest things that's different about how we use Hadoop versus a lot of companies is we actually don't use HDFS as the persistent store behind Hadoop, which seems really weird to people. So we actually use S3. So if you're in Amazon, S3 is like an infinitely scalable object store, and you can use Hadoop on S3 instead of HDFS. Now it's totally counterintuitive because isn't the promise of Hadoop like process your data, do your processing where your data is? But it turns out that S3 is way bigger than any cluster you'll ever spin up. So it can, in parallel, send the data it needs to your Hadoop jobs, and it quickly will saturate your nodes with the data it needs. And we've done a bunch of benchmarkings at Netflix, and we haven't noticed much of a difference between using S3 and HDFS, and we get all sorts of benefits by using S3. So you can only do this if you're in a cloud provider, unfortunately. In terms of big data, what is big data at Netflix? So we process over 500 billion new events per day, and those are things like, are you a member or are you not? That would be something that goes down our data pipeline. Or what A/B test cell are you in? Or what UI interactions are you doing? Or what network quality are we seeing? And these are all things that we can do to improve our experience for all you guys. As far as users of our data platform, the primary users is a group called Data Engineering and Analytics. But we also have a lot of algorithms teams using our data platform, and it is open to the entire company, so a lot of engineers will self-service access the data platform as well. So what does this data platform look like, this mythical thing that I've been talking about for a while? So for starters, in terms of interacting with all the client devices and streaming Netflix, there's a ton of application servers. Those are the things that say, are you a member, are you not? You know, are you in an A/B test cell, are you not? And then they're gonna log data down our data pipeline. So this is this 500 billion new events that I'm talking about per day that goes down this data pipeline and lands in S3. And we think of S3 at Netflix as it is like our central data warehouse. It seems kind of weird because it's a file store, but it gives us a lot of good properties, such as 11 nines of durability, like 99.99999 in terms of how often you're gonna lose something. So it's not something you're gonna get in a data center. It also gives us versioning, so if we delete something by accident, everything is soft deleted and we can recover to it. And it's just the central hub that all of our different data tools will interact with S3. Oh wait, it's not Xero anymore, it's actually Kafka. So, almost Kafka. So we're actually at the point right now, but in about a month, we're gonna be using Kafka for our data pipeline. So right now we're in a shadow mode where we're writing all 500 billion events, both through Kafka and through Xero, and I'll talk about why we're moving to Kafka in a bit. Another core part of Netflix infrastructure is Cassandra is our core data store. So it used to be Oracle back in the day in terms of what is the backend for our various application servers. But in the cloud, you want a distributed system, and Cassandra works really, really well for fast reads and fast writes. The problem with Cassandra is that it's geared towards very specific questions. So like, again, are you a member, are you not? Lightning fast response. What it's not so good at is, I want to arbitrarily join data. You can't do that. Or you want to join it with things outside of Cassandra. Obviously, you can't do that. So we developed a process a few years ago called AegisThis, which we've open sourced, so it is actually relevant to folks. Where you can, it takes the files underlying Cassandra, crunches them down, and then persists them onto S3. For us to use and then process with Pig and Python on top of Hadoop, which is what we use for ETL. So that'll take essentially the dimension data that comes out of Cassandra and the fact data, if you're a data warehouse person, that comes out of Kafka, and it joins them together. So you can join like, oh, these people in this country stream this much on these devices. So those kind of ETL jobs where we'll summarize data and collapse it down and put it back in S3, that's Pig and Python. For now. The next technology is Hive. We've had this in the mix probably around 6 years or so. It's a workhorse for querying data. So for ad hoc analysis, people will use Hive for now. And then we are also pushing a bunch of data into Hive and Teradata. So this is for if you want faster query performance. We've had this for quite some time. It's certainly going to be faster than Hive. And what another thing that it does for you is it's very good integration with other tools like MicroStrategy and Tableau because it has good ODBC drivers and really rich ecosystem built around those. We also have another reporting tool called Sting, and this is more in-house, homegrown, where MicroStrategy and Tableau are a little too heavy for our core engineering team. They didn't want to learn an ecosystem of reporting. They just wanted to take their data, plop it somewhere, and do a visualization on top of it. So what we do here is we take Hive queries, we load the results into memory, and it'll pandas data frame, and then you can sort of slice and dice it after that. It's obviously limited to memory at that point, though. Presto, I'll talk about in a little bit. This has become now our more de facto querying engine for ad hoc use. So if you want to query something, we typically say use Presto. It's a heck of a lot faster than Hive. If for whatever reason, if the scale or the lack of UDFs becomes an issue, then we say fall back to Hive. So people use both Presto and Hive quite a bit in our environment. Druid is another thing that we more recently added to our tech stack, at least in the batch world or the data at rest world. Where people are starting to have use cases that are like, I need massive scale data handling, and I want interactive response time. And the other tools that I'm in here don't quite handle that use case. They let you flexibly query things, but part of that flexibility is usually giving up either performance or scale. So for our A/B testing results framework, we use Druid as a backend, and that lets people really quickly filter and aggregate over the data. And then Spark, I'll teach you guys what Spark is later. So, but anyway, I'll talk about what our experiences have been with Spark, and it's been a long journey. So on the faster front, what are we doing that is making our platform faster? So I mentioned Presto, so let me dive a little deeper into what Presto is. So Facebook open sourced this a while back. We've had it in production for almost 2 years now. And as I said, it's been a godsend for us. One of the beauties of it is that it actually uses the same data and metadata that our Hadoop ecosystem uses. So the same query, that's why I was saying it's so easy to move between Presto and Hive. You don't have to marshal data back and forth anywhere or have a copy of the metadata somewhere else. And the fundamental principles behind Presto is typically what it tries to do is load the small tables into memory and then stream the big table through it. And because of that, the big table can be basically any size. It does have provisions for like distributed hash joins and some other things to deal with two big tables. But you know, it's bread and butter is more about like a big table and a bunch of smaller tables. So why did we choose Presto versus alternatives? Probably the gating factor, the most important thing for us is that it works in Amazon and it works with our ecosystem. So we use S3 as the backend for Hadoop. We don't use HDFS. So Impala, for example, wouldn't be an option. You have to have HDFS for that. And you know, you could say, well, why don't we just cache the data into HDFS? We have about 25 petabytes of data, and we don't know what people are going to query at any given time, so that would be very expensive. So instead, we just say, hey, we just hit the data raw on S3. It's open source, which obviously, you know, we love it. A lot of you guys, I'm sure, love open source technology. This is in more in contrast to traditional MPP type databases, but it's really nice that if we want to contribute to it, which we've done quite a bit, not as much as Facebook, but we have the ability to do that. And being able to control your own destiny is a very powerful thing. It also, another bonus, of course, is that you don't have to pay for it as you scale, other than the hardware. It's Java-based, which fits the development profile at Netflix. So at Netflix, we are a Java shop and a Python shop and everything else. So, but mainly a Java and Python shop, and then the everything else is because, you know, we have to deal with Windows-based devices for streaming, and some people have like a special language that really works well for a given use case, but primarily Java, and if you're dealing with applications at scale, Java is a really good choice. Scala is actually a good choice as well, which I'll talk about with Spark. Another thing is real-world big data. So it came out of Facebook, so this is obviously not an academic project. It has to handle their data, so if it can handle their data, it can certainly handle your data, and it does work at a small scale as well. And then the future, you have Facebook that's heavily investing in it, companies like us are investing in it. A very interesting entrant recently was Teradata, actually is starting to provide enterprise support for Presto, which I thought was quite curious at first. But you know, I think it makes sense potentially for people that they need a vendor that supports Presto. For us, you know, we're doing direct contribution, so we own our own version. But you know, one thing that's nice is that they're going to come out with an ODBC driver later this quarter, which we'll definitely take advantage of, and a JDBC driver next year that are enterprise grade. So Spark, the darling of the industry. So we've had an interesting saga with Spark. So we first started looking at Spark in around early 2013, and it was cute or fun, not so pretty, I would say, back then. We would take like one of our bigger tables, we would load it into Spark, and then we had to keep winnowing it down, and we got it down to an hour of data. Granted, it was about a terabyte, so it's not small, and we would tip over Spark pretty easily. Fast forward it to today, and we have about five different teams at Netflix that have light use Spark in production right now for algorithms or stream processing. And then recently on my team, we have Spark now running on our Hadoop cluster. So we're running it on, you know, Yarn is the resource manager under it. Kind of accidentally, I guess we have one of the biggest Spark clusters out there, just because we happen to have a 1900 node Hadoop cluster, and we're running Spark on top of it. So yay, yay us, we're big. But we're not pounding Spark jobs on it. It's mostly Pig, a lot of Hive that are running on top of our Hadoop cluster right now. But I think that the big thing for us is that, you know, Pig has historically been our ETL language, but we see so much promise with Spark that I think more and more our ETL is going to transition over to Spark. So what are some of the takeaways for Spark, the really high-level stuff, and some of them are our direct experiences? One of the best things, obviously, about Spark is the cohesive environment. So you get your Spark streaming, you get your graph processing, you get machine learning, you get your Spark SQL, you get your batch processing, like everything is all in one package that uses similar APIs. And that makes it a lot easier when you're, say you wanna do a stream processing job and you want a batch processing job and you want the code is almost the same, the business logic's almost the same. Well, if you create a Spark streaming job and a Spark batch job, it's gonna be really, really similar. On the other hand, if you're creating a Storm job and a Pig job, then you have a lot of context switching and duplication of the business logic. So that's really nice. Maybe in contrast to it, but actually an enabler, is that you also can do it in multiple languages. So you can use Java, you can use Scala, you can use Python, you can use R more recently. If you really want the best performance, Scala is probably the way to go. It's what Spark was written in. But you know, for ease and for smaller stuff, you might want to use Python. A really informal test, so this is not something to like go back and say don't use Python ever, is, you know, we took one of our jobs and we ran it in Python versus in Spark, and it was about 3 times faster with Spark. And I imagine that that's going to, over time, that'll get closer and closer. But I imagine Scala will beat it even over the long run. Performance 100 times faster. Is it 100 times faster than whatever you have right now? It is 500 times faster. No, I'm just kidding. Every single technology always seems to say we are 100 times faster than usually Hive, which is a really unfair comparison. But what is our real world experience? So what we found is everywhere, anything between 1.3x to 6.9x versus Pig jobs that we've written. So we just did our own internal benchmarks. Our data is going to be different than your data, but we did try to be fair. So we optimized the pig job and we optimized the Spark job. The 6.9 was an extreme case where we knew we were going to be reusing the same data set over and over and over, which we knew Spark would do really well with. But it's a little more realistic. Now, if you really want 100 times performance, it's like do a point query. And then if Hive has to spin up a JVM, you know you're gonna crush it. But once you start getting to real data sizes, then you're not going to get 100x performance. But probably one of the best things about Spark is the community. So as I said, 2013, you know, AmpLab was going around talking to lots of companies and a lot of good stuff going around then. But since then, it's just exploded. You have Cloudera that's first class support of it. You have Databricks that's spun up. You have tons of different companies that are contributing to it. The most active Apache project out there. So if you have a solid foundation and you have a great community on top of it, then the future is grand. And I think that's why we're thinking that, you know, even right now, Pig is a good fit still for us, but looking forward to how much Spark is moving along, we anticipate using Spark more and more for our ETL. So the takeaway is bad, and I put bad in quotes. These are more like considerations, so they're not all bad. The first one is maturity. This is actually, the story is getting better and better over time. You know, as I said, back in 2013, it was like, there's no way. It was fun, I guess, to play with it. But this, especially for small scale data or medium scale data, it's working. But once you start running at scale, that's when you're gonna be the pioneer. That's when you're gonna start hitting issues that other people haven't hit. And we've hit plenty of those over time. You know, we haven't even, as I said, unleashed the floodgates because we still have a lot of pig jobs running. But like just a random example of something that we hit was if you were using Spark SQL or data frames and you said, I wanna request data to the Hive Metastore, if you ask for a particular day from a table, it would send back all the information from all the partitions in that table. And if you don't have that many partitions, it's not actually the data, it's the metadata for those partitions. So if you have a small scale amount of data, no big deal, it would just send it all back to the client, and then that client driver program would filter down to the certain day. That works well, except if you have 1.2 million records that are coming back just the metadata about your data, and then it takes minutes just to get a result. So that was a patch that we put in recently to Spark. And you guys might discover some of these things as you move along as well. But the nice thing is other people are, and they're gonna fix them. Multi-tenancy and concurrency, this is another thing that the story is getting better and better. Those five teams that I mentioned before that have Spark running in production, they all have small clusters and they're all running independently because they don't want to crush each other with, you know, oh, how much memory do you need in this cluster and that cluster and contention like a streaming job versus an algorithm job, like a lot of badness could be there. But in our environment, you know, we have Spark now for running on top of Yarn. So this is a big win because you have all the goodness of the Yarn resource manager that you're not going to get out of Mesos or standalone. It's a better story in terms of Yarn. So tuning, I put in gray, plus and minus. Like if you're going to directly program using Scala against the API, then you're going to have to, whatever you execute more or less is going to be what get executed in the Spark engine. So you don't have that optimizer like we have in Pig. So if an analyst writes some code, Pig will optimize things a whole bunch before it actually gets executed. So this is a blessing and a curse depending on how well you write your code. But this is getting mitigated as well over time because you have things like Spark SQL and data frames, and they have the catalyst optimizer. So that's going to take care of some optimization for you at the logical level. Scala, again, a blessing and a curse depending on who's writing the code. So some people in our engineering organization they don't really love Pig and Python because it's two separate environments. They wanted to use something like Scalding or something where it was more cohesive for the business logic and data flow, but we didn't find something that was like the clear winner out there. And then you had the other extreme of analysts who are like, whoa, you know, Pig is too hard. So it was like Pig was sort of a nice sweet spot. But again, like I think some of that is gonna get mitigated by having Spark SQL as an option or PySpark. But you know, so Scala, some people are gonna love it, and then other people, you have these other options in the Spark ecosystem. And then current investments, doesn't matter what technology you're looking at, that's always a consideration, is what do you have now? We have a lot of pig jobs out there. They're not gonna go away anytime soon. So it's a balancing point, like how much maintenance and investment do we keep making in Pig versus leaning forward into Spark? Next topic is stream processing. So stream processing, the first question is, do you actually need it? If you don't need it, then don't do it because it's just extra work. So a lot of companies can get away with just batch processing of jobs. They don't need this, I need this right now for what? Like, are you really gonna do something differently based on you getting the data right away? And then if you need some light operational feeds from production, sometimes it's easier just doing like point to point from production to, you know, store off some information. But At a certain point, if you start having more and more use cases where you do need data more quickly from your production systems that everyone's building their own point systems or bringing their own frameworks, then it's better to centrally say, at least here is a supported framework. If you want to go off and do your own thing, maybe you can do it, but you have to support it. So from a consistency perspective and when somebody needs a stream processing framework, it's nice if you need it that you have something available to them. And we have more than one at Netflix, and I'll talk about that shortly. So why would you actually want stream processing? It's mostly about latency. You need the data more quickly because you need to make some sort of action or you want to see some sort of insight or send off an alert. Another sort of sub-reason is around scaling. So depending on the nature of what you want to do with that data, it could be more efficient to stream the data because instead of getting all the data into some central repository, HDFS, S3, and do this massive processing on top of it, you can process it as the data's in flight. Now, it doesn't work with everything because sometimes you need to join it to a whole bunch of other data at scale, and then how do you fit that into a stream processing job? You could do it with smaller sets of data, but it is a way of getting more out of your hardware in some cases. And some people ask us, like, hey, we're Netflix, we're in the cloud, why don't we just at midnight like quadruple the size of our Hadoop cluster, and then we can just power through all of our batch processing jobs, and we don't need the stream processing. And that sounds good in theory, but it just doesn't actually work that way. The cloud is not quite the cloud, you might think, because most of the hardware that we have in Amazon, we pre-reserve, because it's much, much cheaper if you have reservations for it than if you do it on demand. So as a consequence of that, it would be very expensive if we just always were spinning up extra hardware. We love the elasticity of the cloud. So like when you really need it, we're willing to pay for it. But for the most part, it's better just to have a reservation and you have it available 24/7. And you pay pennies on the dollar, relatively speaking. Another thing that's hard about scaling way up is then you have to scale back down. And often you have jobs that are running on your cluster. And actually EMR, Elastic MapReduce, which you're using, they're actually doing some work right now to do better graceful shrinking of clusters. But there's still some more work to be done there. So which stream processing framework to use? I wish I could tell you which one that would be worth the admission for this particular session, but it is hard to say. A couple years ago, Storm had a lot of interest at Netflix, and that's pretty much waned at this point. No ding on Spark, no ding on Storm. It just happened to be that Spark was more alluring, or we had other use cases, and we didn't. And also, it wasn't like stream processing is not like the bread and butter. I shouldn't say that. We do have some pretty strong, compelling cases for it, but the people that started using Storm, they sort of stopped looking at it. SAMHSA, we do have SAMHSA in the mix. We didn't at first, but I'll talk about it a little bit in terms of our data pipeline. And then Spark, we'd love that to be the choice, partly because we will be using Spark for so many other things. And if you have one clear winner, that's good for everybody. I don't know that that's the case. It's not the case yet, but if the investment keeps going, then we'll see. We also have some internal stream processing frameworks that are really powerful within Netflix. One's called Mantis. But there is something to say for having a community behind a technology versus it being more your own. Another thing on the faster front is Parquet. So we used to use sequence files for our data warehousing for Hadoop, but we moved over to Parquet. Most of the modern formats for analytics are columnar. So more efficient scanning, you can skip a whole bunch of data when you only want a few columns, much better compression. It's also cross-project, which is one thing we really liked about Parquet. So whether you're using Spark or Hive or Pig, like it's a first-class citizen for all those. It also has a good community behind it. You have Cloudera investing quite a bit in it. Twitter historically has done it. We've done a bit of it. And any of these companies and any of you can contribute to it. So we've actually made some enhancements to work well with Presto and with S3. So Pig on Tez, that's an interesting one, where we actually invested a fair bit last year to get Pig running on Tez, the new execution engine in Hadoop, but we kind of got ahead of where Tez was, so we didn't have the rich debugging information and consoles that we had historically in Pig on MapReduce, and then so we paused things. And in the meantime, Spark has just gotten so much more traction that I don't know that we're gonna go back and invest on Pig on Tez. We would love some other people in the community to finish it up, so please do that. There's also another project, Pig on Spark, that some people are working on. Again, we would love for you guys to do that because we have a lot of Pig jobs out there, but most of our investment is gonna be directly in the Spark ecosystem. Okay, changing gears onto easier now. So data pipeline, that's kind of a weird thing to put in the easier category, but the reason it's easier for us is it simplifies our architecture, and I'll show you a picture of that shortly. But one of the big things about Kafka is it gives us durability. So it gives you, for one thing, you can have guaranteed at least once write and better durability once it persists than we had with our Sero pipeline. And we would either had to fit that into our Sero pipeline or move to something that has a stronger community behind it. And I can't overemphasize how important a community is for a technology, because it might be great now, but then what is it going to be a year from now? And Kafka is just becoming the de facto choice for data pipelines at scale, at least in my my humble opinion. So, and I have no vested interest in Kafka. I don't own no shares in Confluent, or if you know Kafka. That's another thing that's nice about Kafka, is that the folks in LinkedIn, they spun off their own company, Confluent, that now supports Kafka. So again, people that want an enterprise vendor, that's a nice bonus. So what does our data pipeline look like? This is our current data pipeline. So data's flowing in Sero, goes to S3, gets processed in Hadoop. Some people bypass Sero because they wanted this better durability and they go directly to Kafka. I said this in the last presentation I did. Don't take a picture of this because it's going away. No reason to do it. So the data lands in Kafka, goes onto a router, and then it goes to Elasticsearch, which is really great at indexing data. You can dive down into specific records, filter, do some aggregation, or Druid, which is, we're using a little bit less and less. It is actually differentiated from Elasticsearch, but for real-time analytics, the overlap wasn't quite enough to merit supporting both these tools, but it's good at things like top-end sliding windows, like what are the most error, where am I finding the most error? So there's definitely a use case for it, but we didn't have a strong enough need for it in our streaming world, but we are using it more in our data at rest world, which I mentioned before. And we might add it back in the picture in the future, so I put it in our future data pipeline. But how this is going to work is very similarly, the app servers are going to log to Kafka now. They're going to go to a router. This router, we're using SAMZA, which is what I mentioned before, for stream processing. Really, it's just look at the event type and figure out where to send it. And the reason we chose SAMZA, we looked at Spark Streaming pretty heavily for it, is that SAMZA and Kafka both came out of LinkedIn. They integrate really well together. It's good at scale. And you know, we needed this just to be a hardened piece of our infrastructure. So we chose SAMZA at least for now. And then after the router, we can now decide, do we want to send it to S3 or Elasticsearch or Druid or custom app X? You can send it wherever you want. And the real beauty, well, and I guess the last thing is you can also send it through Spark Streaming or some other stream processing framework. We're still trying to decide what it's going to be. It's most likely going to be Spark Streaming, and then put it back on the data pipeline for anyone to use. So the beauty of this picture, though, is the separation of producers and consumers. And then whether you want to use, and the really nice thing about that is that same set of data, a producer logs it, can be used for both real-time processing, or it can be used for batch processing. Or it can be used for your own custom application. We don't even know what you're doing with this data, but you don't have to deal with all this plumbing and talk to the source teams and figure out how to get the data out and how to have durability. You just say, oh, I'm just going to tap into this router, which will be self-service in the future, and say, give me my data for my subset of events. Another linchpin of our architecture is Genie. So this is like a RESTful service that you can kick off Pig or Hive or Hadoop jobs historically. Now you can actually execute just about anything through Genie, so Teradata queries or Redshift queries. And I'll talk about how we use it in practice, but first I'll say, like, here's one of the reasons why S3 is so great for us. So normally, people have Hadoop. We have S3 as our backend data store. If you're in a data center and Hadoop goes bad, if your elephant gets sick or something like that, then that's just bad news altogether. Like, unless you have some hot mirror data replica somewhere, like, what are you gonna do? For us, it's as easy as spinning up another cluster because all of our persistent data is on S3. The jobs that are in flight, if the cluster totally crashes, they're gone, but our scheduling tool automatically will restart any jobs that are running. If it didn't totally crash and it's just limping along, we'll let the old jobs finish on the old cluster, but new jobs through Genie will go to this new cluster. And Genie just says, hey, I have this Pig job, go to the prod cluster. And then that's just a configuration change where we now go to the new cluster. Another nice thing about this setup is that you can have multiple clusters sharing the same data. So these are both using S3 as a backend, and we can add any other clusters we want in the future, and you don't have to worry about moving data around. We also open sourced a tool called Inviso a while back, and this gives you a lot of clarity into what's running on your cluster. So if you're using Hadoop, especially MapReduce world, then check it out. but it you can see, in this case, there's a pig job. At the top, you can see the sub MapReduce jobs that pig generates, and all the detail of the mappers and reducers, and what's skewed and what tasks failed, and you can use this to optimize your job. Or from a more administrative perspective, you can see what's running in the cluster, who's using it. You can go to your neighbor and be like, why are you using my cluster so much? Why are you that yellow guy? Stop, stop, stop. Or in the bottom, we can see what is the backlog on our cluster, and then we can either push people to optimize their jobs or buy more hardware, reserve more hardware. A lipstick is another thing if you're using Pig that is great for visualizing workflows. So we developed it so we could better debug people's jobs. And it lets you see visually the MapReduce jobs that are happening and see potentially bad things. Like in this particular case, someone did a replicated join. They have, you know, over 28 million rows in memory, which is actually quite a bit in Java, and is probably gonna fail this job. So you'd wanna change it to a hash join. And anyway, you can see it much more visually with row counts. Metacat is a federated metadata store that we are gonna open source soon. I'm not quite sure when. But it sort of lets us see data across, whether it's Redshift or Teradata or our Hadoop ecosystem, if it's S3, just data on S3, but we can actually annotate and add more information, like what is this table? We can also store lineage information about that data, and we have quite a bit of this lineage in place right now. So putting this in practice, this is a really powerful thing, is we can say for this particular Hive table at the top, VHS, account, device, title, sum, what is feeding it? So that's the upstream job, and then what is downstream of this job. So if you need to make a change to this table, you know, you can look, oh, here's an ETL job using this table, I better make sure that we fix that ETL job. Or maybe here's an ad hoc job, maybe I'll tell those people that I'm using it. Or if you want to do cleanup, you know, worst case scenario, you see that there's an upstream job filling it in, but nothing is downstream. So this would help you figure that out. And just so you know, all the slides, I'll make sure that they're posted on Strata later on, Strata site. So Big Data Portal, I don't know if we're gonna open source this because I don't know if it'll lend it to it, but it's a good concept, I would say, is what this does is it's a central place that we say, if you wanna interact with the data platform, we had so many tools and technologies, it was kind of hard to know where to go in some places, and like, yeah, Confluence, things like, it's just hard, you know, documentation never is up to date. So instead we said, just go to the portal and that's your launching point to whatever you want. So that last screen I showed, dependency analysis, that's actually from the portal. This is if you want to find schema information, all the details on a table, like where is it located within S3, what is it partitioned by, who created it. You can set lifetime value so it auto trims the data after a certain date. Like all that metadata and visibility is in one place, as well as there's a little link for dependencies up there. But really the bread and butter of the Big Data Portal is you can query any of our data stores. So in this case, someone's running a Presto query, and then you can see the results. So the results, before the results, you can kill the job if it hasn't run or hasn't finished. The results will just pop up on the screen. And then you can save queries, you can share queries. So it's just this sort of central hub, as I mentioned. And then one of the, you can't really see it. Oh, I'll just put a little red dot on that little thing down there. So there's an information button, and when you click on that, the cool thing is it gives you the code that is running when you do that operation. So it was built from the ground up that everything you can do in the portal, you can do in code. You can all do it in Python code so that if what you want to do is not quite this interactive experience that's in the portal, you can stitch together your code in any particular way you want to do it. And that information button lets you see what it is. So, and we make sure that we don't skip that step. So anything that's in the portal has the code behind it so people can use it directly. And that code is sort of like a DSL in Python. We call it the Big Data API, or Craggle. And the beauty is you just take those few lines of code. So in this case, really three lines of code. You can import the Python module, Craggle. You can run a Presto job through Genie, selecting from a table, saying, I want the headers, I want to execute it, I want to put it in a pandas data frame, and then I want to see the results. And now you can do whatever else you want to do with it, slice and dice it, visualize it. So it's been a really powerful concept. Another thing I didn't show in the portal is that we actually have now integrated notebooks into the portal. So you can fire up a Zeppelin notebook or an IPython notebook, and then without installing anything on your client machine, add code like this. And then when you save it, it saves it to S3, uses Docker running, being managed by Mesos. So the last sort of section I wanted to dive into is, like, hopefully this is like cool, snazzy tech that I talked about, but it's not all about the tech. Like, you can have the best technology platform in the world, but how you put it into practice is gonna make all the difference at the end of the day. So one way to have a really clean, smooth running system is to lock it up and say, you know, here, you know, once a week you can do a release and you have to go to this anointed person to get your code into production. Or you can take the opposite tact and just say, it's kind of wide open, do what you want to do, have at it. Now, if we more or less take the latter approach, I mean, granted we hire relatively senior people, so they've been burned enough times in the past that they're going to make less mistakes than someone right out of college. But there is still this consequence. Even people that have been around the block a few times, things can get messy at some times, and there's going to have to be some cleanup that happens. But this is the development flow that we use instead of saying, here's a big gate in the middle that you give it to this release engineer or this QA team and until it goes through them, you can't get into production. You can get anything you want into production. We call it freedom and responsibility. You're on the hook for it, but you can put anything you want into production. And the flow we have, at least in the data world, is that we start with best practices. So it's not just like go. It's like here's what we recommend doing. Then we have consultation, components, tools, automation to sort of smooth the path and like get help and let just follow this clean path. And then it gets into production. And then the consequences, of course, we're gonna have to do cleanup at the end. You can't skip this step no matter what. Even if you went through a release engineer and a QA team, things are gonna rust over time. The data sizes get bigger. The code's not always perfect. So we just either have to, if it's really bad, we'll catch it quickly. Or if it's not so bad, then periodically we'll go in and we'll do cleanup. And this sort of gets to another philosophical principle that I started talking about this is a paved path to a certain way. The tools and automation, like how to get data into or how to get code into production. Our data pipeline is another example of a paved path. If you log through our now Kafka client, then you will have the data, whether you want it custom app X or if you want it into Elasticsearch or if you want it to S3, you just log it once and it's wherever you want it to be. So this is a really powerful principle, is provide paved paths for people so that they don't have to go and hack their way through the jungle and figure out how to do it on their own. Because if they do, then they're gonna start creating their own wheels instead of using the ones that you've already created for them, and usually they're worse wheels. Now, this is not always the case. Sometimes you will have to hack your way through your jungle because the thing that you need doesn't exist yet, and then you will create this wheel, and then hopefully all together we'll iterate and iterate and iterate and make it a better wheel. So both principles work pretty well, is you want both the paved path to just follow this recommended way, and you have the autonomy to go off into the jungle when you need to and start creating new infrastructure. And like, you know, Spark, for example, that was an example of how sort of grassroots came through our company. So the last big philosophical principle I'll leave you with is question everything. It's amazing how much this is not done at companies. Like there's a release process that nobody likes, or something else. It's just terrible. But you know, it is what it is, and inertia just keeps it going. And then even worse, like sometimes there's like one good reason for it, and everything anchors on that one good reason for it, versus like big picture, like, but everything else sucks about it. So, you know, question everything. The first day that I started at Netflix, I had like a whole team of people in my cube talking about how much they didn't like the release process, interestingly. And I was like, whoa, you know, first day, hello, be nice. But, you know, but they were right. It was pretty terrible. It was using like Perforce, and it was like taking a Unix script and moving code into production and blah. It was bad. And it took more than my first day, but we fixed it. And then the very last thing is, I've touched a little bit on philosophy, but I highly recommend reading our Netflix culture deck. It will blow your mind, I guarantee it. It's not like the normal fluff of, oh, here's our culture, blah, blah, blah. It's like, whoa, can a company really run this way? And I started a little over 5 years ago, and I remember reading it, and I'm like, I'm either really scared or really excited, or maybe a little both. Depends on how it actually plays out in practice. And having been there now over 5 years, I would say it's definitely the good side of what it could be. It's like an empowering environment that you can just get things done. And it follows some of those philosophy principles I said, and there's a ton more. And if nothing else, you probably can find some gems in there that you can bring back to your own companies. And with that, I have about a minute for questions. Thank you. And actually, I'll throw out two other things. One is that Dan Weeks, who's on my team in the back, he is also doing a presentation at 1:15 running Spark at petabyte scale. So I highly recommend that. I'll also have office hours at 2:05 if you run out of time for questions in this 30 seconds. So. We have not looked at Flink. And it was funny, in the Kafka presentation yesterday, they asked who's looked at Flink, and one person kind of raised their hand.
Would your decision to use Sandra instead of like HBase informed by S3
Well, interestingly, Cassandra is not under my team. It's more the operational store. From my perspective, it's just a source system. But for us, the fact that we knew we were going to be in multiple regions, the eventual consistency is actually a good thing. We didn't want the high availability of multiple regions trying to talk and then being stuck in many cases. And it's actually not just eventually consistent, it's tunably consistent. But in our world, if we had to use something, we'd use Cassandra because everyone else is using Cassandra at Netflix. Automated testing. I certainly do not have a framework that I provide for automated testing. So I'm not sure what all the different frameworks that people use. Across Netflix, there's various things that people use, but I don't know that there's like one standard thing, like here is the anointed framework that you would use. Well, Teradata, part of that is that we've had Teradata forever. So we've had it since, I don't know, like 2007 or 2008. And we had a huge code base in it, and Redshift didn't even exist. And then Redshift has been maturing and maturing and maturing over time, and then Teradata came out with a cloud offering after we pushed them for about 3 years to have a cloud offering. And from my perspective, both are great. And whether it's Redshift or Teradata, I want them both to innovate, and then whatever fits our long-term plan the best, we'll move to. We have no specific allegiances. But you know, we do have a big code base on Teradata. It's very mature. Redshift's integrated well with the Amazon ecosystem. It's maturing, so it's a fun race.
Are you guys storing the possible information or information on
S3? Sorry, one more time.
How are you storing the personal
information? That's a good question. So how are we storing personal information? We are not storing personal information. So I said before, we have this big open window and everything's open to everybody, and that comes at a price. And the price is that there is a reduction in some of the analytics that we can do. So this big S3 data warehouse that I talked about, we intentionally keep any PII information out of it. So there's no like credit card information or first name or gender in it, for example, because we just want it to be open. So that's our solution. Maybe one more question, I'm a little bit over, and then office hours later if you want. Yeah, so master data, like we don't have some formal master data management system. I think Metacat, which I mentioned before, is gonna be sort of our central store in some ways. I guess it just works to a certain degree, and we don't have the same governance and things like that that some other people do. And the other thing is like we never acquired a company, so we don't have like disparate data stores that we have to conform. It sort of more organically conforms, and when it doesn't, then we just sort of deal with it, the roughness around the edges. All right, so with that, thank you very much.